Thanks for coming to our panel on reproducible journalism. I'm Garrett Christensen. I am from UC Berkeley at the Berkeley Initiative for Transparency in the Social Sciences. I'm an economist by training, but I sort of focus on issues of research transparency and reproducibility. And so I'll just introduce the panel first, and then John here next to me will take it away as the moderator. So we've got Peter Aldiss, who is a reporter on the Science and Health desk at BuzzFeed News. He teaches science communication at UC Santa Cruz and data visualization at UC Berkeley. Since we've been talking about polling today, he's also written some great stories for BuzzFeed on polling analysis, and related to what we're talking about today, all that data is available on GitHub. Also got a great story, with great visualizations on FBI spy planes, so you can see where they were circling in our area. Next to him is Christy Ashwandan, who is the lead science writer at 538. She's also a health columnist for Washington Post. Related to what we're talking about today, I'm a big fan of her story, Science Isn't Broken, where for 538, where you can play around and do some p-hacking yourself and basically prove whatever you want about political parties and their effect on the economy.
With data.
And down at the end is Dan Finelli, who's a senior research scientist at Metrics, which is the Meta Research Innovation Center here at Stanford. He's one of the first researchers to focus 24/7 on researcher misconduct and bias and related issues. He himself is a former journalist and science writer, so he can weigh in from both points of view on these issues. We've also got Simine Vazir, who's a UC Davis Associate Professor of Psychology. She's a senior editor at UC Press's open access journal, Calabra, and she's very active in the personality psychology reproducibility space. And then Dan Nguyen, visiting professor here at in professional journalism at Stanford. He was formerly news application developer for ProPublica, building tools where you could track bailout and stimulus spending after the global financial crisis. And our moderator is John Bohannon, who is a contributing correspondent for Science. He's written some very interesting stories bringing attention to bad science, deliberately doing some bad but very common statistical practices to show that chocolate could help you lose weight, and did a sort of a sting operation on predatory open access journals. He and I are both at also at the Berkeley Institute for Data Science, an interdisciplinary data group at UC Berkeley. So I'll leave it to John.
All right. So we were tasked with, first of all, coming up with what reproducible journalism is, and then coming up with some questions that would actually shed some light on it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to be completely transparent about the process that we've undergone. So this is meta-transparency. The questions that we came up with roughly divide into two silos. First is the question of what is reproducible journalism and how do we make journalism more reproducible, blah, blah, blah. So that's a craft question. And then the second silo is how do we cover reproducibility itself as a topic? So, you know, it's gone by a lot of names, but let's call it the reproducibility crisis in science. It is a topic in its own right. And weirdly, we as practicing journalists are taking part in it to some extent. We may in fact be complicit in it to some extent. So how do we cover something that we're kind of part of? How do we do it right? And let me just run down for you, just as a kind of like, you know, running your finger over the menu. This is the kind of stuff we're gonna be discussing. So first, how reproducible are journalism stories based on data analysis? So, you know, are we better or worse than the average, I don't know, psychology paper? Should journalists be held to the same standards of reproducibility as scientists? You know, do we get a special pass because we're not so smart? How do anonymous or deep background sources affect this? So this is a question that I find really interesting. Is there really any difference between reproducible journalism and reproducible anything? You know, are we essentially becoming data scientists? Should we pretend we are? What if your data was scraped from the web, obtained from a company that is reluctant to have all its proprietary data out on the web, and so forth? Like, this is maybe an example of how journalism differs from academia. We do have certain privileges and responsibilities that differ. So maybe we can touch on those in this discussion. What format slash platforms should we be using to share our data and code? It seems to roughly divide into the world of R and Python, and GitHub and other similar type open platforms. Maybe we can do a quick rundown on recent experiences and maybe where we hope the rest of the field of data journalism is going. I think that'd be a good one. What is the analog of peer review in the world of data journalism? So, you know, if we journalists are essentially becoming data scientists in practice, what's the analog of the process that generates academic papers in the world of data science? You know, how are we held accountable? Are editors and post-publication, like, ravaging on the internet essentially good enough? What should we do about licenses for reuse of journalist data? Peter, in particular, is going to be addressing this. Okay, so that's the first silo. And then, on the other hand, in our coverage of science, how should we journalists treat issues of reproducibility or the lack thereof in academic research? So, you know, if we're writing a story that's on a topic that is, you know, has a track record of having reproducibility problems, does that mean every time you bring up this topic, you need to sort of footnote everything by saying, by the way, like, this whole area of knowledge is shabby? Or, you know, like, what's fair? Where do you actually draw the line? You know, I see parallels with covering Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton, for example. Like, if you're gonna write about their claims, to what extent are you supposed to constantly remind people that, like, they've been found to be having X, you know, level of falsehoods coming out of their mouth? Science and statistical significance are not certainty. How can we journalists accurately portray uncertainty without painting a picture of science as fundamentally broken? So, you know, one of the pitfalls of being honest about data and analysis as a journalist is, you know, what we're giving people are bite-sized stories, and bite-sized stories do not lend themselves to essentially teaching and providing context that would allow a typical reader to not come to the conclusion that, well, I guess the whole system is broken. I can just stop paying attention to anything that has to do with, you know, conclusions based on research. So, you know, to what extent should we be worried about that, addressing it? And finally, what factors specific to journalism make data reproducibility difficult? So this includes workplace realities, resource constraints, typical workflow for journalism projects. We are not living on academic grants. Practicing journalists, you know, don't typically have the freedom that someone essentially trying to generate one paper per year has. And so we should be realistic about, you know, we can't just say, okay, journalists, we're holding you to the same standard as data scientists publishing in journals. Or maybe we should, actually. Maybe actually we need to think about the paradigm differently. And Christy brought up something earlier today about essentially focusing on one study at a time and the dangers of doing that. Okay, so now you've heard the whole menu. We probably won't really hit all of that, but I just want to remind everyone that I really want discussion to happen, so I'm going to leave time. That means I'm going to be a real bully of a moderator. I'm going to give this half an hour, right? We go till 12:30? Anyone? Raise your hand.
Yeah.
Yes. I'm going to assume we're good till 12:30. It's 11:45. That gives us a solid half an hour of blah, blah, blah. And then I'm going to cut it off, and I really want to hear intelligent, useful questions from you that challenge us. So let's kick it off with the first silo. How reproducible are journalism stories, period? Like, how reproducible are we? Let's hear a report card. Who wants to start?
Do you mind if I run a quick poll? Sort of, can you from the last? How many people in this room are journalists who've published a story that relies upon some data analysis that you've done. Of those, keep your hands up. So keep your hands up for now. Keep your hands up if you published your data in code. So a bit fewer. But still a healthy number. That's actually more than I expected. I didn't come with hard data on this, so that's why I wanted to ask. So I don't know. My first comment is I'm reasonably encouraged by that. And I think if I'd have asked that question 1 year ago, there would have been fewer hands, and 2 years ago, there would have been fewer hands still. So maybe that's good.
So to step back a little bit, to think of it in the general perspective, I think journalism in general is almost inherently non-producible. You know, the typical story of where a reporter goes and interviews someone, someone else interviews that person, you're going to get a different response. I mean, there are most of journalism is just this kind of irreproducible workflow, and I think that's inherent. So as we later on bash journalism newsrooms for not doing best practices, it's important to understand that, you know, there's the common form of journalism is very much kind of this ad hoc process in which you trust your notes, you trust the journalism, you trust that the journalist did their job, but in order the ability to trace it back exactly like you would a scientific study is almost impossible in many cases.
Okay, but Dan, let me narrow you in on what about just reproducibility when it comes to data in stories?
Sure. I think it's, as people think of data journalism being fairly niche, this subset of this idea of reproducibility is even more of a smaller circle of that because it's work. And I think everyone who, both in the scientific community and the journalism community, knows that besides the issues of the worries of getting scooped, there's just the worry of limited resources to do it. So the few newsrooms that really do a lot of data journalism, there's even fewer of those that have the resources to do the work that needs to do the work that to produce their work. Sorry, to publish their data so that anyone else can use. That's something that's more uncommon.
I would say if the question is, should science journalists be held to the same standard as scientists, I would argue that's a pretty low bar. And I would hope the bar would be higher. At least when it comes to transparency, I think part of the reproducibility crisis in science is realizing that we haven't met the basic standards of transparency. And it sounds from the show of hands that journalists are doing better. And I hope you wouldn't use science as your comparison point, because I think we could.
We may have quite a select audience here, though.
That's true. Yeah.
But so may I interject around this, just to specify one thing, which was, in fact, the thing that I thought I should mainly bring to the table around reproducibility and around the science of reproducibility that's sort of only really starting now, which is we don't really know what reproducibility means to begin with. There is a very sort of narrow sense which comes from, not coincidentally, computer science, of reproducibility as having the code, and if there's data, the data, that would allow, in principle, anyone to sort of exactly reproduce the study. And that is a new concept in science, coming from the fact that we have computers. Now, with this perception, and I'm going to insist that it's, in my view, it's still a perception that needs to be understood better, that there is a reproducibility crisis. This perception comes from having exported that concept to the empirical sciences, and then enmeshing the idea of reproducibility with what were previously understood as being a range of different ways in which knowledge could make progress through what used to be called replication. But it wasn't just one type of replication. There were many types and many ways in which knowledge would be assessed and constantly improved. And so that said, you know, going back to journalism, I think there is definitely a basic sense, which I understand is probably what we want to talk mainly about here, about making it reproducible in the sense of making it transparent. And it's what definitely applies well to all the sciences, certainly the social sciences. But anywhere beyond that, so whenever you come close to trying to understand if what is being said is true or correct or condivisible in some way, then you're just entering into murky waters, which science hasn't solved, so let alone journalism can.
So Daniele, what is a good working definition of reproducible journalism then, just off the cuff?
So, well, I guess what I just said, I mean, there is a narrow sense which we can all agree upon, which is...
code and data.
Code and data. Arguably, yeah, I mean, making the study in principle verifiable by anyone, you know, verifying exactly what was done and how the results were produced. Then everything else that currently, I think, sometimes at least in the current narrative around reproducibility gets enmeshed in, you know, essentially whether what you're saying is true or not, that's not going to be solved, I think, in... it should be, in fact, I think, kept separate from it.
Yeah, I think there's kind of this wrong idea that you have these data and there are answers that are either true or false, and that is very rarely the case. I wrote about one study where they actually gave the same data set to a bunch of different analysts and had them go at it, and they knew that they were going to be sort of, everyone was going to be sharing the answers, so no one had, you know, any sort of incentive to cheat the data or anything like that, and they got a lot of different answers. They were all sort of in one direction. I believe it was the Upshot. Someone recently did something similar like this with polling data, and they gave them to different groups. So same data, everyone's giving it their best shot. They're all trying, no one's trying to be deceptive, but they're getting different answers. And so I think it's really important to keep this in mind, that it's not just, if you take the same data and do another analysis and get a different answer, it's really, we have to sort of put aside these ideas of like one thing's right or one thing's wrong. They are different interpretations. I mean, I like to say, we're always sort of looking at data as though it has the answer, but the data is just sort of the starting point. It's how we interpret it. And almost universally, when there are disputes or discussions about things, it's not about the data themselves, it's about the interpretation. And that has, a human element that you can't get away from. It has value judgments, it has these decisions, it has, the garden of forking paths, whatever you want to call it, whether those things are being done intentionally or not. But it's something to really keep in mind when we have these discussions.
I absolutely agree, but just to avoid the risk of, slipping into some sort of a postmodernist view of knowledge as non-existing or being completely subjective, the whole mission of science, in a sense, is to overcome that human element, in that the interpretation that you give of the evidence comes from, a whole range of other information that, as an expert in something, you supposedly have as your background, which guides, therefore, where the truth is or where, the right analysis should go. So I'm not going to argue that there isn't any truth to be discovered ever. I hope none of us, especially
that's along, we are supposed to be looking for
along those lines. I know you didn't mean it, but just,
There's degrees of robustness, right? And in the example that you gave of the reanalysis of the red cards in soccer matches, as you mentioned, all the results were in one direction. And you could have imagined it coming out very differently, where some teams found strong results in the opposite direction. So even though there's variability depending on the specifications with the same data, sometimes there'll be a lot of variability, and sometimes all the different specifications will converge on a pretty narrow set of answers.
And I would argue in those cases where you do have discrepancy, that those are learning moments. I mean, there's knowledge to be gleaned from that, and that's not necessarily, a sign that, oh, this is being done wrong, or there's, a problem per se. It's that, what is this telling us about the question that we're asking and the data we're gathering in service of it? Are we measuring it? If we can't get a consistent answer, does that mean that we're measuring the wrong thing to try and do this? Is there some factor that is invisible to us that's actually the thing that's influencing it, and so we're sort of measuring the wrong thing or drawing the wrong conclusions from data? I think that's something we have to remember.
Hey, Christy?
Is possible.
We are approaching the T-minus 5 minutes of the midpoint of blah, blah. So Peter wanted to bring up a point, and then I'm going to switch to the next silo.
Just an observation from that, and I thought that there's a big cultural difference, actually, between science and the social sciences and journalism. And what, in most cases, when somebody comes in and does the big data job on whatever story it is, mostly other journalists don't come in and pick up the data and do a reanalysis. What they do is they go, wow, that was a great scoop. Now I'll get some ideas from that and I'll go off and investigate another topic. So there is a bit of a difference. I mean, I absolutely agree. We should have transparency. We should say what we've done. And I have, increasingly so, and hopefully I'll always be doing it going forward, been publishing data and code. Very rarely does anybody, I think, kind of reanalyze my data. I've had my data used for other studies and published, which is great. I have not, and I doubt it's because I'm so great at what I do. I mean, I haven't had to, I can't think of a case where somebody said, hey, I've reanalyzed your data and I've come up with a different conclusion. And I think it's just because it's not happening. And I think it's a difference in culture between the culture of journalism and the culture of science and social science. Now, I don't know what the answer to that is or whether that's a bad thing for journalism. I'm just putting it out there as an observation of that's the way I think it is. So there is a little bit of a difference. Nobody is actually, for the most part, I think we're doing a reasonable good job on transparency. We're not, for the most part, trying to reproduce what one another are doing.
Well, let me end this first half with a question that each of you is going to get a shot at, which really seems to be the motivating question around this, which is, what should we as journalists essentially demand of ourselves? So you can either answer this by giving me a no-no. For example, mine would be, never clean data manually. You should always write functions that you then publish with your code and data. Everything should be released together so that someone can essentially see every single step, ideally with comments justifying why you dropped all these guys and did this to all these strings. And really, even a lot of the good guys in data journalism don't do that, and it's a real pet peeve. Or you can, just answer how you will, but Daniela, take it, and we're gonna just go through the line, try and keep it brief.
So yes, essentially, as I just mentioned, I think the only first step is that of just trying to make as raw as possible the data available. And if I may just quickly enlarge that to non-data journalism, I see still not entirely used opportunity to actually always substantiate any journalistic story. So one point that was made in the great keynote that we heard this morning was the possibility that there is a crisis in, or rather that the public doesn't take fact-checking seriously. In my impression, and it's just a sort of a citizen impression, actually the opposite is what's happening at the moment, is that the public now is able, or think they are able, to actually do their own fact-checking all the time, and they do it. And by now they have access to every possible point of view on any possible claim. And so I think part of the problem, if people stop listening to journalists or just believe whatever political candidate they like, independent of what they say, is that because of the situation, they're losing trust in whatever they're told by so-called experts or so-called journalists. And so the only way out, again, of that is showing that whatever you're saying is as transparent as possible and as self-consciously limited as possible, which again is one of the lessons journalists can get from scientists.
Thanks, Daniel. Dan?
Yeah, I agree with having raw data being one of the best ways to show transparency. And in terms of just the practice of reproducibility in journalism, what I like to keep in mind is just the things that make that possible, like all the, whether you're thinking of version control, a reproducible workflow and all that, all of those all the things that you have to do for that are also best practices for when it comes to both fact-checking, when it comes to if you're doing a crowdsource story or you're trying to distribute your work so that more and more people can see it, and also in the case of a situation like at ProPublica, where they often do a big story and then they release their data to other news outlets, you want, as if you're the person behind that project, you want, it's just a matter of efficiency. You don't, people ask you questions, they don't understand the data, you want to be able to walk them through it step by step and know exactly where everything came from. And of course, if you're able to do that, you've basically, you've theoretically instituted all the mechanisms needed to do reproducible journalism.
Yeah, I would just echo everything that Dan just said. And at 538, you know, we usually share our data. We share our methodology, but we post things on GitHub, and we try and be as transparent as possible. And yeah, I think that a lot of the best practices here are the same sort of best practices that science, you know, should be using as well. Although, you know, as she mentioned, they don't always succeed at that.
I haven't got a whole lot to add. But I'll just maybe throw up something which may lead to where we're going, which is, what actually is the raw data, and are we able to share everything that started off as the raw data? And I certainly often, what I share has been processed in some way. Well, like particularly, like I can't put hundreds and hundreds of gigabytes of raw data up on GitHub, and in certain circumstances, the provider of that data would not allow me to do that. But that's another question, I think.
I would give the same answer I would give to scientists, which is that there's a lot of incentive to cherry pick the best result, the result that supports your conclusion the most. And I would hold yourself to a standard where you also force yourself to present your most damning result. So the analysis that is least supportive of the conclusion you want to draw, so that you give readers the opportunity to weigh all the evidence and consider how you could have interpreted the data and drawn a different conclusion. So not just cherry picking the
best
result.
What would that look like? Be specific.
So when, you know, Christy mentioned the garden of forking paths, when you're doing an analysis, there's a lot of different ways you could go in terms of dropping outliers or including covariates and so on. And at least in science, there's this this practice that's developed of just presenting the one that looks the most beautiful and polished and significant. Ideally, you would present all specifications and show the range of possible results you could have gotten. There's often not the space to do all that. So one shortcut would be to present the outcome that you think that you trust the most and explain why you think that specification is the best, but also the analysis that is least supportive of your conclusion. And then it's on you to explain why that's a less good analysis, and on your readers to evaluate both.
I actually like that idea. And I think in journalism, that could actually lend to our narratives. I think it actually could be a cool tool. And that does indeed seg perfectly into the latter half, which is reproducibility as a topic that you're writing about and covering as a journalist. The motivating question here is something Christy really articulated well today when we were discussing it, which is, so we're in the business of telling stories. There's no way around that. You could argue so with science, but you know, in a very explicit way. Our job is to tell good stories. So how do you do that while also being honest and rigorous about the data, its limitations, the garden, you know, the getting lost in the garden on your way to certain conclusions? You know, how do you strike the right balance? And this is a moving target, right? That, you know, our readership is getting more and more educated as time goes on, hopefully. You know, there was a time when you had to define DNA in a story. You had to spell it out and you had to say what DNA was. That those days are gone. Ditto for the internet. And hopefully reproducibility itself will evolve along these lines, where it's just going to be part of the fabric of the assumed narrative that we all, you know, share. So why don't we just for, I don't know, geometric interest, let's bounce it back this way, starting with you. Where do you think that balance lies? And what makes it hard or easy?
Yeah, I don't envy journalist jobs. I think it's really, really tough to figure out how to portray the things that are broken in science without making it sound like we can't trust anything in science. But I would say as a scientist, I rely a lot on journalists to speak truth to power and to say when we're wrong and say when we've been blinded by our own incentive structures, by status, and so on. And we should be doing that ourselves too. I don't want to outsource that to journalists, but I think one role that journalists can play as outsiders is they have more freedom to do that. We have a lot of politics and so on in our world as scientists, and we can't always call things out as bluntly as I think a journalist can. And you know, a lot of psychologists are upset with journalists for undermining public trust in what we do and so on. And while I do think at some point we need to worry about that, I think we're still pretty far from that. I think that we're still in a space where we need to focus more on what's wrong with a lot of science and help point out those flaws and put pressure on science to fix itself. I don't think science is broken, but I think there are a lot of flaws. And I think right now what journalism can do best for everybody, including scientists, is to help us put pressure on us to fix those problems.
Yeah, I wrote a story, the headline was Science Isn't Broken, and I really believe that. It's not the science that's broken, it's the way that we think about it, it's the way that we present it. You know, right now the public sort of has two conflicting ideas about science. On the one hand, they think, oh, it's all bullshit because yesterday coffee was good for me, today it's bad for me, et cetera. You know, so they you know, think that it's either yes or no answers. And on the other hand, they think, oh, it's this magic wand that touches, you know, things, it turns everything it touches to truth. And I think that those two narratives are related, because if you think that science is a magic wand that turns everything to truth, then it's really confusing when one study says one thing's true and another thing says another thing is, right? And but we all know, those of us that do have done science or think about it, write about it, that that's not how it works. It's really sort of a process of reducing uncertainty and clarifying uncertainty. And that uncertainty is not a shortcoming of science. It's inherent in the process. It's baked in. And I think as journalists, but also scientists, we've done a terrible job of explaining that to the public, of teaching that. And look, some of this comes down to human nature. Like, the human brain is terrible at dealing with uncertainty. Like, we don't intuitively understand it. We don't deal well with it. And so, you know, it's a tough challenge. And I can understand how we've gotten here, but I think as journalists, one role that we can play is just doing a better job of explaining this uncertainty, of you know, being careful that the way that we cover studies and that we cover science is not, oh, new study, now we know everything, this is the truth, about, you know, putting it into larger context. Now, we have a lot of pressures too, and depending on where you work, I have the luxury of working at 538, where we really are sort of more interested in getting it right than being first, and you know, we sort of do things more in depth. But there's a lot of journalism out there that just by its nature is daily journalism. They're looking for news. The other thing that's happened, and particularly with medical and health stories, is that there's this sort of endless appetite for new shiny things, and there aren't new shiny, I mean, there's not a new amazing breakthrough every week or even every month, and yet you have this hole to fill. And so there's this pressure to create that. And so we need to somehow get away from that. Often we'll make decisions that this study's coming out, there's all these press releases, I know everyone's gonna cover it, but we're not gonna do it because we shouldn't be covering that story. And Peter and I were talking about this a little bit earlier.
So that was certainly where I was kind of going. There is this fundamental tension in journalism. We always want the shiny new things. That's what we're reporting on. And that isn't the way human knowledge progresses, certainly not through the scientific method. It's lots of contradictory steps back and forth, but it moves in a direction through the body of evidence. One thing I'd observe, I'm a science journalist. I have some concerns about how the people who write about studies as a group have kind of been a little bit corralled by the system in that—
Peter, you want to make your strong claim about Eureka Alert now?
I'm going to talk a little bit about Eureka Alert. So the journals kind of tell us all what is new, and we follow that. And there is this sort of, if you're not familiar with the way the sort of academic PR and journalism game works, there are a few sites that are clearinghouses for press releases, and the most biggest and most influential of them is called Eureka Alert. It's run by the AAAS, the American Association for the Advancement of Science. I must admit that when it was hacked in recent weeks and went down and people didn't have access to it anymore, I was kind of smiling inside. I think those of us who cover this stuff, and I understand that like Christy, I'm lucky enough to work on a news desk where we are more sort of approaching a story and trying to assess the totality of the evidence around it, which is much easier. And I think probably leads to better journalism. But many journalists are under pressure. No, the shiny new thing, the shiny new thing, the shiny new thing. And it is exactly going to create the problems. But I think if collectively we can sort of try and move more in that direction and realize that we don't have to be told what is news by Nature Science, the New England Journal of Medicine, and Eureka Alert. And I used to work for two of those, Nature and Science, so you know I have great affection for them. But I do think there is a little bit of a herding and chasing the shiny new things that if we could just move away from it, we'd be better off and the world might be a bit better off.
Dan, Daniele?
To reiterate, or not to add much on to what's been said, but not only does the news business depend on fooling everyone and saying, hey, what we're writing about is new to you, so buy our newspaper today. There's also, covering uncertainty is hard because as a journalist, you don't want to admit to being uncertain about something when you report on it. And so, you know, combine that with if you're thinking of your stereotypical mainstream journalist who doesn't have a science background, the incentive to report on, oh, like all the nuance and uncertainty of what sounds like an exciting study, it's just not in their mindset. It's just not something that's going to be encouraged typically by the editor, and then it comes out in, and then the reader sees it as this very non-nuanced story, and all the scientists get pissed, and it's hard to break away from that circle.
Yeah, and uncertainty doesn't make for good stories, right? And at the end of the day, I mean, that's the tension between storytelling and data and uncertainty and science, and it's really difficult to strike the balance. I mean, people really want good stories. In a lot of cases, you know, they want to say, don't tell me about all this, just tell me what to do.
Yeah, we are touching on the essential element, I think, of all the problems we might be discussing, which is incentives. No, and I think here there is a lesson to be learned from what happened in science, in that the alleged, at least, trust that the public has or used to have, but I think it still has, in scientists, doesn't come so much from the perception that John mentioned at the beginning, that sort of a scientist or a smart, you know, or the particularly objective people, but actually comes from the understanding that, at least in principle, the way science shaped itself is as a system in which it's in your best professional interests to be as sort of careful and prudent about your claims as possible. And there's no reason why, in principle, that shouldn't happen in journalism, although...
I want to push back on that. Maybe I missed the claim. You're saying scientists are incentivized to be as careful and accurate as possible?
Public thinks
so. But you see, where a perception of a crisis part, you know, might come from is precisely because we seem now to understand that maybe that's not the case. But this is where the interesting lesson from science comes in. Because whilst a lot of what we're talking about in terms of biases, reproducibility, et cetera, isn't actually new, it might have a new vocabulary, but these are old problems. One of the real objective historical novelties has been the fact that we started to tackle on an institutional level scientific misconduct and all ever more sort of, you know, what are called questionable research practices and all these behaviors. Essentially, we started to put black and white at the institutional, even at the national level, definitions of what is good research behavior, and if people don't comply, we have structures that sort of make them officially accountable for them. And this is only, it's a new invention. It only started, as a matter of fact, in the US in the 1980s. Before then, it was just given for granted that somehow the system was able to police itself. It strikes me that this is something that could happen in journalism as well, that somehow, I don't think, I could mention a few examples, but I guess it's better to leave it very generally, but I can think of objective examples where there were objective issues of accountability and, you know, punishable behavior that wasn't punished. Nothing was done about behaviors that were objectively, you know, with raw data in hand, shown to be questionable. And so that's, for example, in my understanding, is a huge area where good lessons can be learned from science and imported to journalism, and would improve journalism quite a bit.
Guys, we are at exactly 15 minutes left. I want to open it for questions. I can see you're itching to jump in, so why don't we start with you addressing that, and then I really hope you'll come bring some questions to us. Please only ask questions with the mic so I don't have to repeat what you say. People who have mics and are running around the room, just look for people, and if you have a mic in your hand, you're one of those loose mic people, when you raise your hand, hold up the mic and I'll know that you're ready to do that. So take it away.
So just real quick, one more lesson I think that journalists can learn from scientists, and I see this mistake on the horizon, is the idea of assessing the totality of the evidence is not simply just averaging all the studies out there. We made that mistake for a really long time. We thought meta-analysis would save us. It doesn't. And I think you really, really have to pay attention to the quality of individual studies, and you're better off reporting on a few high-quality studies than just a simple aggregate of all the studies out there.
Hello, I am among the research scientists on NOSIX project, the reproducibility project that you wrote about, and I loved your treatment. It was my favorite treatment of anything published on the reproducibility project because it captured the excitement of that uncertainty, and indeed, since leaving science, I've been a programmer, and now I just started a newspaper, The Oregonian, where I'm observing that indeed we are beholden to people's interest in breaking news, and I want to know whether what you think about the possibility that the interest in breaking and new and shiny can be met not with an absolute finding uncertainty, which we know is a misguided thing to pursue, but the way in which we are developing insights and kind of inviting readers into what is shiny about science at all, which is that kind of process of discovery and iteration.
Wait, so just to be clear, you want to know...
I want to know what you think about the feasibility of leveraging the desire for breaking news, the new and shiny, as a complement to the nature of scientific inquiry itself, which is iterative and uncertain and curious.
So I don't think that, I'm speaking just for myself, I guess, but I'm not saying that we shouldn't cover breaking news or that there's never any news, and there's sort of going to be that appetite for it. And if you're working at a news site, there's sort of, you know, this desire to have something just not be out of nowhere. But I think that if you are covering something, you know, that has that sort of news hook, then you put it into the context. So maybe it's about being a little more sort of explicit about, look, this is really kind of an artificial news hook. Like, there's just happens to be something happening this week, but it's not the thing happening this week that's like, whoa, 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 but it's like the thing happening this week that's like, hey, this is a chance to think about this cool thing.
Awesome. I would just add, here's a tale of two stories. You know, we land a probe on Pluto. That is breaking news, and we need to write about it at the end. A social psychological study finds that holding warm orange juice actually makes you feel X. You don't write about that one as breaking news. Why? Not even just the obvious reasons that it's probably underpowered and all that stuff. Let's say it's not. It should be put in context. Like, why do you care about how humans feel when they hold a mug of orange juice? You should actually say, well, for the past 10 years, here's what we found about mug holding in general, and it's actually kind of gone up and down. It's actually an interesting topic. And you've got a story that I think is richer, but like, it really depends on the story in question. I think we do a really bad job when it skews towards like iterative
stuff that has to do with daily life, because it lends itself to storytelling.
I would just like to add a very quick thing about this, because I think part of the tension, I mean, it is true, but I think part of the difficulty comes from the fact that a story needs to be simple, now that somehow the mission of a journalist is somehow give an understandable, a manageable picture of what is potentially a very complex issue. And so you'll talk to someone for an hour, and they'll give you all sorts of different ideas, and from that you'll boil to, you know, you boil down to two or three quotations that you'll add to your text. But talking about reproducibility, I think there's a very elementary thing that everyone can do nowadays, and it strikes me, you know, that they don't do enough of that, which is, why not provide the text of the entire interview? Or in fact, the whole recordings of all the people that you spoke about.
I can think of a lot of good reasons why not to do that.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, okay, so here's one. Here's one, for example. Let's say I tell a source, I'm about to interview you, and by the way, I'm going to publish every single word you say. That interview is going to be markedly different in content than if you don't have to make that claim. So, I guarantee.
Maybe so, but like in my experience, it also happened the other way around. I mean, this idea comes from suggestions that people I saw made in commenting on articles written about them where they were quoted, saying, you know, fair enough, but, you know, what we talked about was a lot more nuanced and a lot longer, so, you know, why not, you know, they were encouraging essentially the journalist to do that. So I guess at least with the consent of the interviewer, that is something that many of us, certainly I would subscribe to.
So, I mean, this model that you're describing is more of a congressional interrogation version of journalism, where essentially you're compelled to, you know, say, you answer questions within your rights, you know, limited by what you don't want to say, but like with the understanding that essentially every word matters. And the problem is that then you've essentially removed the judgment of the journalist. Now the journalist is essentially just a, you know, a typewriter, transcribing bits and bobs from an interview that you should just read in the raw text.
No, but you see, this is where the humility of the scientist should transpose to the journalist as well, in that one should be aware of one's own biases. You know, it's fair enough that you're giving your point of view, you're providing what your best understanding of an issue is, but you're fallible like anyone else. And so if you have the means to offer other people, you know, the possibility of developing their own point of view, then I think as a journalist, that's part of your mission. It could be. I don't want to...
No, I like the idea. It's radical reproducible journalism.
I just think most people don't have the time.
Yeah.
I just think it's a doomed exercise.
Right, but people don't...
Just for that reason.
But people with Google Transcribe, you just like basically feed the audio from your interviews through... Exactly.
But people don't have time to reproduce the data journalism either. I mean, it's the same issue, but it's an issue of... It's a matter of transparency, you know, fundamentally.
Guys, I want to make sure we get more questions, so let's have the next one.
Yes, it seems like you all agree that sharing your data and sharing your code is a good idea. And I'm wondering if you could speak a bit about how to make it easier. GitHub is great. But in that case, they have to kind of know that you published it at GitHub. Have you thought about something like a central repository, or at least a place where you can go that links to your data so you've published, I've published my data?
Before anyone answers, I actually want to get three questions in the running. You.
Oh, great. I wanted to go back to the beginning of the conversation about the nature of reproducibility itself. In the physical sciences, anyway, the thing you're usually trying to reproduce is the data. You know, you say, I've done this experiment, I have this apparatus, I measured the following. And then the analysis and the conclusions are something else that's open to interpretation. In journalism, it's a very different kind of question because the experiments aren't reproducible. They're things that happen, you know, one-off. Somebody might have said something, you might have a photograph, it happened once. There's no reproducibility of the data itself. So I wanted to sort of get some exploration into that difference and what is it that we're trying to reproduce in journalism itself. And I'm kind of in the middle of this because I've been working on computational linguistics for quite a while, and that's, it looks like science because you're doing all these statistics and computation, but it's really about human behavior, about things people say.
Got it.
Once and then they're done.
Got it. Thank you.
Hi, yeah. So I think there's a difference between transparency, by which you mean sharing data and code after an analysis, and peer review, which is theoretically getting comments from other people in your field before the story or the paper even runs. So Peter, you said that nobody really like reproduces your code and data, even if you share it. Like, then maybe the discussion should revolve around like how to get people to comment and discuss even before publication. So I'd like to hear your thoughts on that.
Got it. I'm gonna kick off this triple question extravaganza by saying what I do peer review wise is just, I don't know, it's a random answer to a good question, is I always find secret cohorts, accomplices, before I publish a story, and they're never named. It's just like peer review. It's like the secret behind the process. But I always get at least one expert to look at my data. And Peter, I think you do the same.
Depending on what it is, if it's something where, I mean, certainly within our team, we will review each other's code and check we can follow it and check it makes sense and check we can reproduce it. So within the people who do data at BuzzFeed, we'll be doing that pre-publication. We, you know, when we have a substantive analysis, not for, here's a graphic I've whipped up for some data, we don't really need it for that necessarily. I guess I'm a bit, cynical isn't the right word. I think I hope it's realistic about the role played by peer, pre-publication peer review. It really, it's like democracy. It's the best system that is available, but it's sort of fatally flawed. And I actually, when I think about peer review in science, I think the important peer review in science is post, most of it is post-publication. Not pre-publication, where only ever a few people look at it, and mostly they miss what flaws are there. Unfortunately, that's just the way it is. So I don't, given seeing how it works in science, have a great deal of faith in pre-publication peer review doing much to the process of journalism other than slow it down. And I don't think that's a tremendously good idea. I do think we should be challenging ourselves at all time. You need to be your own sort of devil's advocate, and you need to encourage people, and they may be like a trusted source who understands the data and understands how this sort of data analysis, and you say, I want you to tear this apart. And like often, I mean, we have a kind of a BuzzFeed, whenever it's anything where somebody would be criticized or, you know, we have a no surprises policy. They know exactly what is going to be in the article before it comes out. And while we won't necessarily share all of, well, I think actually if we were challenged on it, we probably would share data and code with them. And, you know, if I'm going to be embarrassed, I want to be embarrassed before I publish and not after. So, you know, I see it certainly to my advantage to challenge myself. I'm just not convinced that a sort of formal process of external pre-publication peer review is, I just don't think it's going to improve data journalism.
Dan, I would love to hear your thoughts on where to put your data. That was one of the questions. But before you do, I actually want to grab three more questions. We probably won't get to them, but I really want to hear what your questions are, okay? So no statements, just questions. Starting.
Boy, I was going to make a statement.
Turn into a question.
I'll put a question mark at the end. I'll just have that California uplift. So my name is Steve Goodman. I'm one of the directors of Metrics that Dan is part of. The issue of reproducible journalism is a problem because it goes way beyond the data and code. I mean, as was evidenced by the prior session, you need to know the questions that were asked, the amount of missing data, the methodology. All that needs to precede it, and gradually you become, you need the same transparency or completeness of scientific report. The data and code are meaningless if you don't know how the question was asked. So it's a recursive process, and you end up, if you're going to be really checked for reliability, having to have as much detail or more than a scientific report. So you really need to be very careful about what's necessary to create the validity that you're looking at. I thought your answer about the radical transparency was interesting, because you were expressing a certain reverence for judgment that you would criticize very strongly in scientists. So,
not so much reverence as like, I just want to tell really good stories and I know it's going to be 10 times
sometimes
harder.
Sometimes the scientists do too. But I guess the question I'm going to ask, so that's just a statement about reproducible journalism. You really have to define how far back you're going to go and how what's useful. But I'd like to register a complaint about the word science. There is many communities in science. Science is not one thing. There's fantastic differences in the cultures, the methodologies, the criteria for claims, the standard practices of physics, nutritional epidemiology, ecology, etc. And you cannot talk about science sensibly. So my question is, how can you actually make these important nuances between the sciences that are critical? If we talk about science, we end up with a nonsensical conversation because the different fields and domains of science have completely different problems, even though, yes, writ large, transparency, honesty, you know, does apply to everybody, but the details matter.
Okay, thanks. Question.
Cool. Hi, my name is Peter. I'm actually working on a data analytics collaborative platform. But my question is it the moral obligation of journalists to not only make it transparent but easy to reproduce the reproducibility? I know, Peter, you mentioned that like you, no one else, or maybe one person reached out to you to reproduce the data. Is that fundamentally a problem of just having all the code out there, or is it more of a problem of potentially having it in a form that's inaccessible to the majority of people who would like to reproduce that data?
Very good point. Thank you for that question.
We've talked about how it's difficult to strike a balance between sort of nuanced reporting about science and like reasoning about uncertainty and the need to tell good, simple, compelling stories. Is there a way at least to sort of leverage the power of, you know, web technologies to treat this sort of as a human computer interaction problem and sort of embed that context and that uncertainty in a non-obtrusive way, sort of behind the story, for example, with tooltips? And I've seen some of this in like the Atavist magazine has done that with like the Mastermind story. And sort of, I know that's extra work, but I think that would be very helpful because I oftentimes find myself
like
sort of,
D3 the hell out of this problem.
Yeah, like I find myself like searching for the research paper, but I don't really want to read the whole paper. But if I had some more context in there, it would be very helpful.
Gotcha. And since I've got you, one more.
Yeah.
One last one.
Hey, my name is Che. I'm a data scientist at Airbnb. We have big need for reproducibility in our research because you don't want to drive the business to do wrong things, and invested a lot in making this open source knowledge sharing platform that like emphasizes reproducibility and this sort of thing. I'm wondering, like, how kind of along the lines of the other questions is, how does tooling enter the conversation of culture of reproducibility? So for us, you know, we're always like, oh, make sure you send it to someone and check it over and all these sort of things. But it was only really once we invested in an end-to-end tool that was like, write it, start in a notebook, it naturally goes to GitHub, and then a web app ingests GitHub and publishes it in a
What
nice
are you guys
correlate.
More or less working in?
So we developed our own, we work in R markdowns and IPython notebooks. You can also write normal markdowns if you have like, you know, survey data, and you can take presentations and shard it into PDFs. But from there, it like naturally just goes onto GitHub, and that's just a nice place for collaboration and commenting on things. And then once it merges, it automatically goes into our web app. And so by making this really smooth end-to-end process, that's when like suddenly reproducibility and discoverability and consumability like became so much better. So I'm wondering about the interactions of tooling and culture in this conversation.
Got it. So Dan, I would love to hear your thought about where we should be putting our data, and then anyone can just jump in on any question you've heard.
Sure, so where should we put our data? I'd say by far and large, among news organizations, GitHub is the place where most people do it, and I think the reason behind that is because GitHub is also used to basically build every other part of any project, including the other facilities of deploying the application, testing it, and so putting code on there is a natural feel for most data journalists, and there's also a lot of conveniences in terms of just publishing attractive, readable README files, and so, and I think that just gets to the heart of the organizations that do the reproducible work. The reason why they do it so well is because it's just part of their process. Like, they're not doing it just out of altruism. It's also just part of their workflow, and it makes them more efficient. So you have to think pragmatically, basically.
I think we are getting an executive order, or not yet. Do we have
veto time? Override? Yeah. Just one more comment.
Someone just jump in.
Can I address the, there was an interesting question I thought about, sort of you might put all of this code and data up there, but does anybody kind of look at it?
I like that question too.
So I can tell you what I do, and I guess I just see it as part of sourcing. Like if part of my story depends upon a claim about a document I've obtained, then I'll put it on Document Cloud, Ted Han is here, and annotate it on Document Cloud, and there will be a link to that annotation straight out the story. And I think it's the same with analysis and data and code. We will link straight out from the story where it, the point it's appropriate, where we mentioned we did some analysis, so you can go and read it. How many people do that? Very, very few, I think. I think very few people actually go and follow the links to Document Cloud and look at the documents. But I see it as just, you know, it's transparency. People should know my sources as far as I can, unless there's a reason, that my human sources as far as I can, unless there's a reason to protect their identity, should be identified so people know who I'm talking to. The analysis I've done, people should know what I've done and be able to look at it and see what the data it is. If I'm quoting that a government document or something I've obtained in some way says this thing, people should be able to see that it says this thing. And I know that most people aren't interested in following up that, and they either trust me or they don't trust me because I think I'm a biased hack, but it's there if people want to look. And then, you know, in some cases, we will, as individual journalists, make an effort to use social media to say, well, here's the story, here's the analysis as well. And I also try and tweet other people's analyses, because I think it's a good thing, like, just to draw attention to, hey, look, journalists are actually revealing how they've come to these conclusions. So let's shout about that. It is a positive development in recent years. I would like to see more of it. I think we'll see more of it. I think there's still huge things to be sorted out about what best practice is and how we do it. But we, let's say, hey, yeah, this is a great thing. And this is where you go and find it.
As a psychologist who studies self-knowledge and self-deception, I feel compelled to bring up that it's really easy to focus on the problem of tools and how are we going to do this and how can we make things more transparent. I think that's a really important obstacle to solve. And I think it's easier to talk about because it's more tractable. But another huge obstacle is self-deception. And I think that's going to be the harder one to solve. Even if people put up what the evidence that they want and so on, there's always what they could have done but didn't do, or what they could have analyzed but didn't. And how do we solve that problem of people still being able to cherry pick what they make transparent unless we have very, very strong norms and rules about what must go up?
3 points. We'll reconvene at 2:00 for a keynote. We have a lunch sponsored by Google News Labs, and please thank such a wonderful panel for such a great discussion.